And today's expert came from a note from one of you. Well, kind of, sort of. All right, so I think her name is Erin, said, you mentioned salamanders might be a possible upcoming episode. My grandkids found their first one this summer and were as thrilled as I am when I find one, which has been extremely rare. I would love to learn more about these beautiful little creatures. So we invited our good friend back. We want to learn more about tiger salamanders for you. Amphibian reptile specialist, Jeff Leclere. Right? Did I say your last name right?
That's right. We got it right now.
So yeah. Jeff was on a couple of weeks ago, maybe a couple of months ago now, talking about turtles.
Mm-hmm.
And like, you just love the turtles, and we were all excited about the turtles.
Yep.
And then you mentioned salamanders, and people have been emailing ever since.
Oh, yeah.
So now you're back with salamander.
That's right.
I love it.
The real thing.
Tell us about the salamanders you brought.
Okay. Well, these salamanders, again, we're probably getting a lot of emails about salamanders, because these tiger salamanders are the ones that you, around the metro area, that people often see in their window wells. Oh my gosh, I've got a tiger salamander in the window wells. Or you hear the old stories when they used to be a lot more common of, oh, we used to have tiger salamanders or salamanders in the window wells all the time, and now we hardly see a one. These are those salamanders.
I think I was telling you a story when you're here talking about turtles, that when I was growing up, we had these in the window well at my grandparents'
mm-hmm.
home, and I put a hose in the window well because there were like 50 salamanders. I had a whole bathtub or a little kiddie pool full of them.
Mm-hmm.
I don't feel like you see them around as much anymore.
Not anymore. And, you know, there's several reasons for that.
Yeah.
And, of course, you know, their habitat is shrinking, of course. That's one the biggest thing.
Okay.
They need two parts in order to survive. They need wetlands, because they breed in the wetlands in the spring. They lay their eggs, and then their larvae hatch out in the wetlands in the spring, and so they have to have those wetlands. But the rest of the time, they spend on land. So they come out of the wetlands, and then they need those uplands, kind of those pasture-y areas. They don't live in the woods so much, but they really like to live in, like, native prairie or open grasslands or things like that. And even though they spend most of their time underground, that's still an important component. So they need the wet, they need the dry, and now that's all shrinking. But also, we're putting a lot of stuff in our lawns and there's a lot of like pollution and runoff, and so that goes right into those wetlands.
Mm-hmm.
And so it really, really, and these guys, they of course kind of breathe through their skins. They have that really moist skin,
mm-hmm.
so they not only take in water, but they also take in oxygen through that skin. Well, anything that's in the water goes right into them as well.
All right. So. Tell us about these three ones that you
have here today.
Chris is dying to hold one.
Okay.
It's been so long.
That's the calm guy.
That's the calm guy. This guy, he's a little wily, so I can hold this guy. These guys, as a matter of fact, were rescued from a window well up in the Anoka area.
Why do they gravitate toward window wells?
I don't get it.
It actually has nothing to do with the window well itself. Remember I said that they like to spend a lot of time underground?
Yeah.
So they're staying low to the ground, and what they do is they hit the side of a house. And it's sort of like, instead of going around and going the other way like maybe we would do or some other animal would do, they go along the side of the house to try to get around it. So they're just kind of skirting the side, and then they hit this window well. Well, unfortunately, these guys, they don't have a good depth perception, so they just kind of lumber along and go right into the window well. And then they're like, uh-oh, because those window wells are deep.
Yeah.
And they don't climb very well.
Yeah.
Yeah. So these guys are then just stuck in the window well.
Kind of a crummy place to get trapped, right?
Yeah, it is, because it's oftentimes dry in there. And, of course, they can't go very long without, you know, having some moisture.
So if you find one in a window well, what do you do with it?
Play with it.
Yeah, exactly. It's very simple.
Do you keep it as a pet?
You just finch it. Well, unfortunately, you can't, because they're protected in Minnesota. All salamanders and amphibians and reptiles are protected in some form in Minnesota. So it's not a good idea to keep one as a pet. But you certainly can fish it out of the window well. Just get down in there and get him out, and then just let him go on his way. Maybe take him a little ways away from the house.
What is their role in the ecosystem and in the circle of life?
So they are sort of like, they're part of that food chain, and they're in the middle of the food chain.
Mm-hmm.
So these guys love to eat bugs. They like to eat bugs and earthworms, a lot of garden pests. So if you have a garden, you kind of want to have these guys around. And then as larvae, when they're in the wetlands, the larvae are eating a lot of things like mosquito larvae.
Ah.
So they're cutting down on those mosquitoes.
Wait a minute, so I can get salamanders in my yard and get rid of the mosquitoes?
It will help. It will help with those mosquitoes
because
these guys have voracious appetites and they'll eat a lot of mosquito larvae. But then when they become adults, even at this size, they become food for a lot of other animals.
Well, I don't want that.
No, I know we don't want that, but that's, again, the role that they play. Yep. The other interesting thing about these guys is that as far as like being beneficial to humans, they can produce a type of like toxin, and we use those toxins for a lot of things like pain relief, or they help with diabetes.
Wait, Jeff, are you saying I should lick this salamander?
No, I am not saying that at all. No, no, I am no way saying that you or any of our viewers should be licking salamanders.
Thanks for clarifying.
Right. The other thing is that these guys have amazing regenerative capabilities.
If they grow back their tail.
But not only can they grow back their tail, they can grow back whole limbs. They can grow back their eyes. And of course, this is very, very interesting to scientists who want to be able to do that kind of thing in humans.
Yeah, that's crazy.
So salamanders, I mean, they look a little They look derpy, but I'll tell you one thing.
Moist.
They're awesome, Jeff.
Moist.
Thanks for stopping by.
Awesome.
We appreciate it.
Thank you. This was really fun. What are we talking about next time?
I don't know. It's up in the air.
Let us know what you want Jeff to talk about.
Some type of reptile or amphibian. Yep.
All right. We're on it, Jeff. We'll post more information about tiger salamanders on our website, minnesotalive.com.